Bom dia.
Wait, what are you doing here?
What are you doing here?
Oh.
Just running with my buddies.
Oh.
And I guess they want to work out, so.
That's like the hardest workout ever.
Hey. Ooh, yo guys, I got something here.
Oh man, I was in the middle of my set, dude.
We got the question for this week.
All right.
Shooters asks, can you read that?
The fitness craze.
Will it really make you fitter?
Healthy mind, healthy body. 100%, man. I think if you're not fit of body, you won't be fit of mind.
It's very possible, but it really depends on the person. I believe doing something is better than nothing in terms of working out.
Well, I think it's all about balance. So you gotta balance your actual lifestyle and fitness.
Oh, hey guys. I guess my answer has to be no, right? I don't think that lots of these kind of new fitness crazes are focused on just looking good. I don't think they're all that healthy for us, really.
Oh, Shooters, back again. Question is, will it really make you fitter? And I think yes, because the more you get reminded of doing fitness, the more it's likely that you will do it.
The fitness craze, will it really make you fitter? I think it's important to have a healthy lifestyle and work out, eat some healthy food. But I think once it crosses the line of like reasonability, then it becomes an obsession.
Welcome to the show, Shooters, and welcome, viewers. Summer has officially arrived in Korea, and that means that everyone is showing a little more skin and paying more attention to their diets and exercise to get their bodies beach-worthy. And of course, dieting isn't always about just losing weight. It's about getting a healthier and fitter body. But some people are taking this to the extreme. So today, Shooters asks, the fitness craze, will it really make you fitter? As always, we're going to begin with an open roundtable discussion until we come to a unified conclusion. So Shooters, are you well armed and ready?
Yes, we are.
Okay, let's begin. Well, it seems like the fitness craze is really all around the world. We're seeing it all around the world. And I know that you Shooters are also quite active. Yes, most of us anyways. Let's begin with some personal testimonies or how you like to keep fit. Why don't we begin with you, Danny?
Okay. I think the fitness craze is a great thing.
Okay.
I think we've had a non-fitness craze for the past 20 years or so. So to compensate for the unhealthy lifestyle that most people live, I think it's a great thing overall.
And how do you stay in shape?
Usually 6 days a week. And a mix of weightlifting and cardio and yoga.
Oh my God. But,
how many hours a day to do all that?
Hour and a half, usually. Hour and a half every morning.
But wow. Do you have a job? What are you working
at? Do you
have a job? What are you doing with your morning?
But seriously, do you have what are your like commitments to your, do you have like an office job? I'm not, what hours
no, no.
do you work?
I'm a musician.
The working day starts a little later.
Is
okay, that well, right? Jan, you're sort of in the music business too. Do you also work out like him?
Yes. From next month, my plan, Danny has been an inspiration to me with his 5 meals a day program. I'm trying to stick to 1.5 right now. So I'm eating a lot less than you.
Jan works out on the dance floor.
Yes, exactly. That's what I thought, yes.
No, but I do think I do need a better routine. But right now, I'm more doing an emphasis on my social life rather than. Because if I had a routine, I would not see anyone these days.
But it's kind of surprising because you also do some modeling, right? And you know, imagine that staying fit is kind of required for your job as well. No?
Yes. But I've had comments from stylists saying, okay, you're gonna have to start doing something about it soon.
Okay.
Because I'm wearing quite baggy stuff today. So.
We all are.
Much more cautious today, yes. Yeah. What about the girls? What about Noura?
Well, I work out at least like once a week for 2 hours. And I try to eat healthy food and stay away from snacks and, you know, junk food. That's my, like, workout routine.
Yeah.
Once a week.
Have you thought about maybe extending it? Or
no? I don't think
I would like to. I would like to, but except that I don't have time. So sometimes I even struggle to get those two. Yeah.
Walk?
Yes, in Korea I walk everywhere. Back home in Palestine I drove everywhere. So that's a major workout.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, there's a lot of walking here.
Yeah.
Up and down.
Up and down the hill.
I'm like young, I think. Because of my schedule I really don't have time. Mm-hmm. If I have time I want to sleep.
Mm. Yeah, I can relate.
I'm right now I'm prioritizing sleep, and then it's really for me recently it's just work and sleep. Mm-hmm. And if I have a little bit extra time, I want to meet my friends.
Do you also get to sort of work out while on the job, like on the dance floor, or?
Yeah, the dance floor. I work behind the camera, so it's a lot of like carrying heavy stuff and things like that. Oh. But it's not like
real.
Yeah, but it's not like a real workout.
But if you don't move, do you find that you have less energy?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like I used to have a typical office sitting job, and that made me more tired. And the job I have now, it's more active. So I feel like I have a little bit more energy. But when you don't sleep for 33 hours, you don't have any energy.
I guess it's a really big difference in personality. I'm quite busy as well, but I get so claustrophobic that I feel like I need to get outside. Uh-huh. So I work out quite often, maybe not as much as Danny does. But I also
don't. Okay, we can't all be Danny.
Exactly.
We can try.
I can strive to be like you.
You're an inspiration, Danny.
But I don't do the weight thing. I just like playing sports. I like playing tennis, playing basketball.
That's awesome. I wish I could do that.
And I make time. It doesn't matter how busy I am. Mm-hmm. I just really feel so claustrophobic or lethargic from sitting in an office all day long that I need to get outside, and it feels really good. I feel like I sleep better.
In sports, you get that competition out too.
I love that.
In a healthy way, right? Like a little less of that in the workplace is a great thing.
Now, Barry, what about you? I know you're busy, but you've also got a wedding coming up too.
Extra
sort of incentive.
Wedding itself, I don't think has put any extra incentive on me yet. But actually, for a very long time, I was very, very unhealthy. I was a very heavy smoker for maybe a decade and a half, I was a heavy drinker for about the same as well.
Bad boy Barry.
just before I turned 30, my doctor said, if you continue like this, you'll have your first heart attack before your 40s.
So. You started that when you were 15, that lifestyle.
You made
15, 16. So kind of typical Scottish youth.
Oh, really?
But let's not go into it too much. Okay. So anyway, around about 29, 30, I thought I needed to make some lifestyle changes. So around about that time was when I first started thinking about becoming healthy or trying to be healthy. And so these days I go running maybe 5 or 6 days.
Sometimes? Well, even with all your preparation.
I can squeeze it in between classes. So I can nip down to the gym on campus for, you know, 40 minutes, and I can do that for, you know, maybe 5 or 6 times a week. And just like Travis said, though, it's been a revelation, like just in terms of your psychology and feeling positive and sleeping and extra energy. So it's really been a fantastic experience. Definitely.
So for those of you who don't work out regularly, do you feel that it's gone too far then, this fitness craze?
No.
I work out regularly, but I have very grave reservations about what we'd call the fitness craze. And I think it's actually very problematic in the way that it's constructed, how fitness is defined from culture to culture. Mm-hmm. And I actually think the way that it's tied to consumerism is very problematic for us as well. So I think we need to think about it as a macro trend, and we need to look at these micro trends, which have all sorts of problems with them and are frequently debunked and have very high injury rates. Mm-hmm. So I think there's different issues that we need to look at.
I would definitely question how effective it can be, because a lot of times when you talk with, especially here in Korea, with Korean women, because of the way that the media portrays what beauty and fitness is, it perpetuates those stereotypes, goals, especially in fitness and maybe desirability of how we look, are never ever going to be met because we can't live up to the standards. I mean, for people like Danny here who works out every single day and has like the Greek physique.
but I
don't know about that.
Yeah, but I want to point out the celebrity part in Korea. Also, when artists come back for press conference, the main question is like, how many kilos did you lose for the comeback? Yeah. Or like, what kind of diet do you do? Oh, I eat the one cup diet. I only eat food that can fit in a cup. And like all these girls who are like crazy about these.
But this is common in America too, like in Hollywood.
Really?
Well, in Hollywood, like pretty much every movie that's come out the past 5 years, the male lead role is like really jacked and really ripped, right? Mm-hmm. And the first thing that comes out on Men's Health or Entertainment Weekly is, how did he get to look like that? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, I mean, I agree with you guys in a lot of ways that the things that people see are like, people don't realize how extreme you have to go to get that physique for that movie. And that's the difference. These celebrities are doing it for a specific period of time, for a shoot.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
And they have a lot of backup.
They've got a lot of backup. Yeah. And they're only doing that shoot. They don't look like that every day of the year.
No,
and that's something I think most people don't know.
But it's funny that this fitness craze comes at a time when countries around the world are actually getting fatter, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, according to OECD statistics and also those from Korean government, I think the obesity rate in Korea has gone up slightly, but the adult obesity rate is one of the lowest among OECD nations. Mm. And especially for women, it's very low. But for youth, it's going up, I hear.
Yeah,
that's a trend that's being echoed all around the world. So it seems kind of paradoxical. You've got this fitness craze at the same time, and you've got this obesity.
I think it comes as a problem. Mm-hmm. As a reaction to the fact that the obesity rates and the overweight rates are increasing.
Yeah.
And this fitness craze also happens in countries that do suffer from a higher obesity rate. Yeah. So for example, like in Palestine, in the Arab world, obesity is only recently obesity started to increase. For example, in Saudi Arabia there is like 70% of obesity rate.
Wow.
In Palestine, it's 72% among adults and 23%
really?
Among children. Mm. However, people in Saudi Arabia don't really practice much sports, and like only 22% of men and 16% of women. In Palestine, it's even it's a little bit more. 50% of the population is engaged in sport activity, but I think this fitness craze it's not a major thing back in
there. Is there a subculture of it there? Like
I think it's also how like the body is perceived. So thin is not perceived very pretty or attractive.
Okay. It's exactly the same case in South America. Mm-hmm.
Thin is not pretty.
No.
It's not attractive.
But then there's
they prefer,
a lot of
curvy
women.
And it's the same numbers in obesity also in South America, but it's totally the opposite in Sweden. 2/3 of Swedish people work out 30 minutes a day.
Every day.
Yeah, right.
No, but yeah, I mean, you even have, there's a famous book that came out, I think, French Women Don't Get Fat, and that was quite a bestseller worldwide as well. Mm. I mean, what is it about the French lifestyle or the diet that prevents people from getting fat?
I guess it's the cooking culture, and the moms would actually always have a balanced diet from a very young age. Mm-hmm. And it's quite, and the portions are obviously a lot.
They're small.
They're just a lot smaller. Mm.
But you eat for 2 or 3 hours, don't you, John?
Yes, but it's very slow. And it's not just eating, it's also a little bit of drinking, but good products.
French, so much more like Epicurean, it seems like to me, like in. Can enjoy a small piece of chocolate, and then they can pause, and then do it again. Like in America, it's just like, how can we make that piece really, really big and cheaper?
There's a lot of talking, and it's not just eating.
Mm. Right. And as for fitness or exercise?
For fitness, it's not crazy, but it's not the bodybuilding culture has not arrived to France yet. People that go to the gym to bulk up are usually club bouncers, or it's kind of like related to dumbness in France. Sorry,
no, it has that relation in America too.
Yeah,
but like the dumb jock, but maybe not as much as
not as much. Yeah. People just tend to run and do a lot of, Travis.
Just sports in general.
Yes.
Okay, well today on Shooters, we're asking about the fitness craze and will it really make us fitter? The fitness craze has really taken over the world, and we posed this question to our online viewers as well. So let's take a look at the results right now. just saw the results of the online poll, and it was quite close. Yes, 58.3, no, 48.7. Were you surprised by those results?
Yes.
You were?
I was surprised by that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would think that more people would say that obviously it would make you healthier.
Yes, okay.
But I think there's a lot of unhealthy fads that are posing as like healthy lifestyle choices that, that probably turns a lot of average people off to it.
Okay. Mm. Is that usually related to exercise or dieting?
I think especially dieting is a huge problem. A lot of misinformation out there. Mm-hmm. People pay more attention to the actual, like the way that it's marketed versus the contents of the food on the nutrition label. Mm-hmm. Right.
Have you guys ever taken supplements, maybe diet or protein supplements to help you? You take it?
Yeah, actually, well, it was before my wedding, and I needed to get into that dress, and the dress was too big.
The dress was too big?
You needed to gain weight?
You needed to gain weight? Okay.
That's awesome.
I know. So, but like muscles building. So I used to, I bought this like gainer thing.
Hey guys,
to gain weight for my wedding.
I was much thinner. I had so much work, and I didn't have time for like
those
a proper, healthy lifestyle.
Right?
I know.
Good.
Just like a milkshake.
Yeah. I did too. But then I also forgot to work out.
So what happened?
I had a bit of a like puffy face, but I look really cute for like 2 weeks.
I did too, but that's because I've been a vegetarian since I was 12 years old.
Oh, okay. Aww. So you need to take those as a...
Yeah, once in a while.
Okay.
Yeah.
Barry, Travis, never?
No, and I've never been compelled to either. There's just nothing that would make me think that was a good idea. In fact, I think that's something that's part of a lifestyle decision that I think is really far removed from where I am in my own kind of personal life, and I guess my own relationship with exercise and health. But it's just not something I'd even think about.
Anything that's made out of a test tube and it's not natural and organic, I'm a little bit wary to take those things and put them into my body.
Most food is like that.
What about medicine? You don't take any of those?
That's interesting though, because talking about healthy food in Sweden, I read the recent statistics is 70% of Swedish people buy ecological food. 70%. So we're very like aware of what we're eating and very organic and
Travis, you too, right? You're very aware of what you put into your body. I mean, when it comes to food, you don't like processed food.
I have my cheat days. I don't like eating processed food. I definitely will not eat fast food. And I try to cook at home as much as I can. But I do have my cheat days. I go meatless Mondays, and I find that I splurge on the weekends
meatless
and eat
Monday.
Whatever
Taco
I want.
Tuesday.
I mean, completely whatever I want.
Does every day of the week have like a title like that?
Swedish schools have that, meatless Mondays.
Okay.
Like school food. Like you don't eat meat on Mondays. Yeah.
Have you guys heard about the runner's high?
Physically speaking,
our brain releases feel good.
Yeah, it releases all these endorphins when you've been running for, I think, 20 minutes or more. Personally, never felt it. But yeah, all these studies say that you feel this high. So this interesting study from Columbia University, they actually researched more than 7,000 people, and they found that if you exercise up to 2 hours a week, 55% said they felt better, like mentally they felt better, they felt in a good mood. But when they exercised more than 4 hours a week, 65% of the respondents actually said they felt worse.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously not the case in some of our shooters here,
but
when you exercise too much, it actually runs against.
It depends on the intensity of the workout that
you have. But I think what you're saying, that exactly lines up with most of the government information that we have. So on the one hand, I think we have the information that's disseminated by sort of health magazines or so-called health professionals. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, we have the advice from sort of health watchdogs or government watchdogs or the government itself. And so, for example, the National Health Service releases the guidelines which are exactly in line with the type of thing you've just outlined.
Okay.
So a certain amount of exercise every week is beneficial for everyone, and everybody should aspire to that. And so for most adults, it is about 30 minutes a day.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't even necessarily say that you have to go to the gym to do that. There are other ways to incorporate that type of movement into your life.
More.
But I think this idea, which again I think is based on these idealized bodies that we see in movies and magazines and pop videos, that's what health or that's what fitness can help you to obtain. I think that's where the problem is.
Mm.
And I think that's why in lots of countries like Britain and America, you've had the health craze at the same time as obesity has went through the roof.
Right.
So I think the health craze doesn't actually address public health in any meaningful way, because the information that's at the root of of the health craze and these different types of crazes that are folded into it aren't actually in line with what health experts advise adults and children to do.
You mean health experts appointed by the government? Like, because I think that's not any better way to get information about it than like the corporations and companies that are making supplements. Like, I think those are both problems. I think because they don't know. Because it's just the same as like most
doctors. Jim Buff in the government. Hi, like, Prime Minister.
I think the best information out there is from people that are in the craze, like YouTube. Like, there's a lot of people that are doing things not for profit on YouTube that are fitness professionals that want to help people and raise awareness in our
community. But Danny, do you think profitable?
Danny, do you think really they're doing it for their, you know, just to make their fellow human beings healthier?
A lot of them are.
Don't really. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Not to be too skeptical, but the consumerism,
And except in Sweden, healthcare is free, but if you have a disease that is because of your unhealthy lifestyle, they will actually charge you more for that. Mm-hmm. If you're like a heavy smoker, like obesity and things like that. So people start to work out to be healthy and to not spend all that money on medication.
I don't think the crazes are necessarily just for people who get the high from working out either. I think it comes with maybe self-confidence issues or self-esteem where they're encouraged by people and they're not used to this, that it helps build them up and they feel a part of this thing that's bigger than myself, like a community, and they're there to support you and they encourage you, which I think a lot of us, maybe we do lack in one way or another, and once we find that we want to stick to it, not just necessarily because of the high that we get from working out.
Adding to that point that it basically boosts your self-esteem and self-confidence, I think exercise is quite empowering, especially for women. I think, you know, it's you feel that you're becoming healthier, that you're becoming stronger, and I think there's, this aspect kind of is totally worth it. I would do it more if I have time.
I think there is, especially with regards to women, it's a double-edged sword, though, right? Because on the one hand, it's empowering. Yeah. Yeah. But on the other hand, there's this immense pressure that women have meant to look like these ideals, right? Okay.
So it depends, I think, on why they do it and why it's done. The goal or the reason behind exercising is very important, because if you exercise because only you want to get healthier and stronger, then you do it differently than when you exercise just because you want to lose weight and look.
Well, at this point, I think it's time to divide up into two teams, as we always do. Fitness craze, obviously, it has its benefits, but risks as well when it's taken too far or when it's done for the wrong reasons. So who here believes that fitness craze is a positive phenomenon that will actually make us fitter? Who believes it will make us fitter? Okay, the three of you, and obviously the other three men, believe it is not. So this time, we're going to divide up, go into our respective armories, and come back with some arguments to convince the other side. The yes team will go to my right, the no team to my left. Okay, let's gear up.
Let's go.
So there's more awareness towards healthy lifestyle.
It's better for the people and society to be healthier.
It saves a lot of effort and like resource waste from governments, right? I think the U.S. or U.S. government spends almost like 9% of their budget on obesity.
It's $116 billion U.S. a year.
9% of the more, national budget.
More than is used for like cigarettes and drinking.
Yeah.
So the fitness craze isn't against being balanced.
I think it should do the opposite. It should actually encourage people.
As much as you can call like this a fitness craze, the bigger problem in society is unhealthy people.
But you're like, you're not obese and you're healthy, you enjoy a better social life.
Best friend's grandfather is 89 and he works out every day and he beat my friend in arm wrestling.
The health fitness craze started, I guess, in what, the 60s and the 70s in America, and it was directly tied to consumerism.
Maybe it's not a good thing for obesity because maybe some people are not motivated enough.
to actually change their bodies so drastically. They just think it's an impossible goal.
A lot of these crazes actually prey upon people who have no basis to understand what good nutrition and working out means.
There's often very little scientific evidence. They're frequently dangerous.
They promote an unnatural body, like the other extreme of obesity.
Media representations, often they give us sort of unrealistic expectations about what we can achieve.
So shooters, are you armed and ready now? Okay. We'll begin 100% convinced of your own stance, but every time you find the opposing team has said something reasonable or persuasive, you will press on the minus button. And of course, if your teammate says something that's very persuasive, you will press on the plus button. The changes in your opinions will only be shown to our viewers and myself, so you won't know where you stand, but we're going to continue now and open fire. The yes team, fitness craze, will it really make us fitter? Would you like to begin?
Yeah, sure. We think so. Basically, right now, we have a huge problem with obesity and overweight. And obviously, people are not working out and not taking care of their bodies, and they don't lead a specifically or necessarily healthy lifestyle. So we think fitness craze would help you on two aspects, right? On the individual level, it will, of course, if you work out and you have a healthy lifestyle, you're gonna become physically healthier, emotionally healthier, and mentally healthier, right? On top of that, it will enable you to practice also a healthier social life and also a far more healthier professional life. On the government and like social, far collective level, we think that governments tend to invest way, like a lot more resources into tackling problems and diseases that are created due to lack of workout and practice, such as diabetes that is caused by obesity and overweight. So we think, for example, the U.S. spends 90% of the national budget on like dealing with people who have diseases like that are caused by obesity and overweight. So we think in this case, you know, we can save plenty of resources and invest them on other aspects. Because these diseases are preventable. It's not like, you know, it's something that just happened to you. It's a disease that you can prevent and you can avoid. So why not? So, you know.
Okay. All right. So the yes team has made their opening statement. Yes. What about the no team?
Well, we agree with lots of what you said, obviously. So sedentary lifestyles have caused a rise in diabetes, and a rise in obesity has also contributed to these problems as well. So there are lots of health problems. And as you mentioned, both in America and in the UK, there is very significant issues with obesity. And as much as 80% of adults aren't meeting the sort of the minimum level of suggested or recommended kind of health measures that they should be taking, whether it's exercise or diet. However, having said that, we think there are very real and very serious and genuine problems with the fitness craze as it's understood in lots of cultures around the world, including Korea, including the UK, including America, and various other locales as well. And so there's several reasons. We don't have one unified statement, but there are several very important reasons which I think we're going to address. So first reason is that it preys on our insecurities and weaknesses. Yes. It promotes an unhealthy, idealized body image, which is very difficult for the average person to attain. Mm-hmm. It's also based on a fitness industry, which is informed by consumerism and capitalism, which leads to a very unhealthy model, and it's not a very good way of disseminating health information. Fitness crazes and health fads are often counter-government recommendations. They're frequently dangerous. There's a significantly higher number of injuries.
Okay, don't give away all of our arguments. You're going to be the only one talking. So.
And, okay. Well, that's where we're starting from. Yeah, we think they're...
Okay.
We think they're unhealthy.
So when it's taken to an extreme, I think those are the main objections that you have, and it could have some negative consequences.
And we think that the fitness craze can be balanced, right? Yeah. I mean, we were talking about this, and we think that there's no reason why it can't be balanced, and you know, leading a healthy life.
It's not a craze anymore, then, is it?
But it needs to start somewhere. But then later you can customize it to the different kind of workout that you actually enjoy. You need to think sustainable, like, will I be able to do this for the rest of my life?
So why does it need to be a craze? Why can't it be fundamentals that you teach at education?
That's cool.
In school, you give them the basis of healthy eating and also exercise. You incorporate it as a part of your life.
I think that'd be great.
Because in some cases, in some countries.
I think that would be great.
Yeah. No, in some countries, this is the status quo. They're doing it, yet still you have a high rate of child obesity.
Yeah.
So maybe we need like harsher approach and we need to be a little bit more aggressive.
And I would think that the craze would not answer that completely because it's like the difference between instantaneous and delayed gratification. Yeah, for a while these crazes, you might lose some weight, you might feel fitter, you might feel a little bit better. But then once you have that lapse in judgment or you slide back down and you have maybe sometimes you don't do what the regimen requires you to do, and you have a day where you go out drinking and you eat a lot, and then you have all these different factors coming into play that make you just feel bad that you can't keep up with this sort of regimen that the craze sort of wants you to keep part of.
So. Well, I think this is where a fitness craze or fitness focus can actually be helpful, because the more there is, the more that people experiment with what works for a healthier lifestyle, the more that there's gonna be different subgroups of types of working out, ways of working out, ways of eating that suit what different people want. Because not everyone is trying to build a beach body, not everyone's trying to be a supermodel. And I think the more that this expands, the more that people are gonna have subgroups that they can fit into, which I think is really important.
But can the fitness craze actually isolate some groups of people, people who don't have the time or who don't have the money to join a gym, or who feel that it's too far beyond their means, or
it totally can. Like I was talking about the YouTube channels, but yeah. I love that because it's free for people to find that information, and there's a lot of it that is tailored to different age groups, different people with different time commitments. You can find people that are building workouts if you have no money. You don't have to go to a gym. You can do it in your home.
We're talking healthy. We're not talking like YouTube is good if you want to learn how to build a computer, if you want to. Information about little things, but this is health. It should be something that's based on like lifetime of research, not like 2 weeks.
Are you saying everything on the internet is not reliable? We can't trust everything we read
on the
internet?
Well, not for our health, for sure. Did you ever Google anything about health on the internet? You're gonna die every 2 minutes.
You feel like you have everything.
Yes. You need to find your reliable sources. I have many friends who don't like going to the gym because they are shy or anything like that. So they subscribe to these channels that have really, really good workouts, and it give like amazing results to them.
Can I just very quickly? Go back to what you said about people often are having problems that prevent them from going to the gym. But there's a policy that started in England this year. The government started this policy to try and persuade more women to go to the gym because women they noticed weren't going to the gym in the same numbers that men were. There'd been a significant downturn in the number of women going to the gym, and so they did some research into this and they found out that one of the strongest themes was a fear of judgment. They were worried about being judged for or being the wrong size, not fit enough, and not skilled enough to come up time again. So I think that's the image of what fitness is actually preventing lots of people from going to the gym. They're intimidated by what their fitness experience is meant to be.
So I know some people who will work out to go to the gym.
That's exactly
before they feel that they have a good enough body to go
really
to the gym.
That's really interesting because the case in Sweden is actually right now 50-50, women and men. And when I go to the gym in Sweden, I see all sizes. I just don't compare myself. I think we have another mentality that we work out to live a longer life and to not spend all this money on being sick. Mm-hmm. And we do want to be healthy and happier.
Can I tell you one of the ultimate crazes that we see every single year? What do you think the number one New Year's resolution is after?
Go to the gym. So
exactly. Yeah. Statistic-wise, they say it's by the second week of January is where the most gyms have the most people working out. But exactly 1 month after that, the people who made that same resolution just the 1 month before and was working out, making that statistic the second week in January, the biggest for most gyms all over the world, that 80% have dropped off the face of the earth.
That's totally true. Totally true.
It's a craze. It's something that's not long lasting. That's why we want to make sure that there are fundamentals, that it starts from an early age.
But you're confusing, I think, the word craze and fad. Like when I hear fitness craze, I'm thinking of like a huge renewed interest in health. Now extreme, I'm comfortable using that word because there's pros and cons to it, but that's different than a fad. And what I think is good about people moving towards, let's call it health extreme, even if it might be too far at times, is the added information. there's more information. As more information comes out, people are learning a lot more about the pros and cons. In the past 10 years, I'm sure you've all felt in your groups of friends, in your social circles, that more people have more solid information about working out and health than they would have 10 years ago. And that's all to do with this.
But why are people doing all this fitness? Like, really, why did you start really? You wanted that body, right?
I love looking good at the beach on spring break 2001, man.
So this is not about good. Health, this is about appearance, but mostly.
No, it's about both.
The fitness craze do offer a diverse way of workouts. Like, you can go dancing, you can go taking walks by the river, it will help you feel better and things like that. So that's what the fitness craze...
No, but what do the fitness magazines say mostly? Mostly, it's all about appearance, right?
I agree, there's too much focus on appearance.
So you're admitting that it's not necessarily making you fitter, it's just making you look better?
I think often it's making both, but it's overemphasizing. A lot of fitness professionals and people more in the industry of selling products are emphasizing the aesthetics.
I agree on that.
I agree there's too much emphasis
on
that.
Let's talk about the guy that will not get as much info as you would and just go to the gym just to look better. And usually a lot of my friends, when they start, they just only do weight training. You know these guys just with big arms.
They
skip leg day.
I
do that too.
Yeah.
And this is where the problem is. Like, these guys will not get healthier. They'll probably just have heart problems of taking too many supplements and all that stuff.
Again, I totally agree with that statement. I see the same problem. And that's where I think the more that this happens, I think people are learning that they need to take a balanced approach. I mean, my hope is that people like your friends, the more that they've experienced that when they have kids or hopefully even before then, they can realize, hey, don't go to the gym for these reasons. Do your research more. Like this didn't work and this is why. You know what I mean?
Well, the thing is, I think we're talking about getting healthier, and Barry said earlier that the statistics and some numbers show that we don't actually need to go to the gym to be healthier, right?
Well, that's the advice from the British government, okay? The British government spends about
What do they say?
The British government spends about $10 billion a year on various health measures, but one of the problems they have is sort of cutting through what they call the diet and fitness propaganda to just get decent information out to people. And these are the people, the 80% of people in Britain who are not getting enough exercise, and the increasing number of obese children and obese adults. But what they say is that they shouldn't necessarily refer people to the gym. There's actually other steps that people can take in their daily lives just to reach that sort of goal of basic health, basic fitness.
But gym is a fitness? I don't think fitness craze means you have to go to the gym.
What we also need to think about is we're talking about micro trends here, okay? But if we look at the macro trend of the fitness craze, okay, and part of the macro trend of the fitness craze is actually the establishment of gyms and fitness clubs and health centers, and what's tied to that phenomenon, which is a huge multi-billion dollar industry, multi-billion pound industry all over the world, is what's tied to that is how fitness has been constructed culturally. And what I think my main argument personally would be that is the way it's been constructed is a negative thing for society. And that's why obesity has risen exponentially at the same time as the fitness craze. And one last thing I'd like to say is, when this fitness craze got exported around the world, what happened in countries like Fiji and in Japan was that they started seeing instances of anorexia and bulimia. And that too is tied to what the Western concept of fitness is. Whenever that image is exported to another country around the world, we start seeing escalating numbers of cases of anorexia and bulimia. And that's tied to very real and serious health concerns, which are nothing to do with genuine health.
No, I think we can all agree that too much of something is not good for you, right? So we're not discussing the obsession around working out. That's not how we see the fitness craze is, right? I mean, yes, there's the word craze, but we think craze can be balanced with healthy lifestyle, with practicing well and eating well, and doing other stuff in life that you need to do, like working and other stuff. But I want to go back to the point which basically Travis presented earlier, that people want to make this kind of exercise. Every new year, you have New Year's resolution that people want to work out more. I think it's natural because people naturally want to be healthy. right? Everyone wants to be healthy, and people want to extend their being and, you know, live longer. Right. And so I see like this fitness craze is only a natural reflection of people's desire to live long.
Well, we're not disputing the increase in activity. We're disputing the craze, because it is a bit of a fad that it's only going to last for a short time. We're saying that that's not going to overall make you fitter. What's going to make you fitter is if you have the basis, if you have the fundamentals of knowing what good nutrition is. This is unrealistic for the core of people, the layman who maybe never does work out at all.
Yeah, 90,
and then they
90%.
Feel that the doctor tells them that they should work out, or that they feel that they want to get healthier.
You keep saying like craze and fad. Like, to me, people who are focused on fitness are the same people that are helping people like you know that that isn't the way to get healthy. Mm. Like, you learn that from people who actually learn that and research that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I think the more that that happens, the more that the general public is going to catch on. And the public has to, because obesity is a serious problem.
Well, speaking of the public, why don't we take a moment now to see what the average person on the streets of Seoul thinks about this issue.
규칙적인 생활과 운동을 하면은 칼로리 소비도 되고 지방 연소에 좋으니까 아무래도 불필요한 그 몸에 안 좋은 찌꺼기 같은 거 날려버려서 좋지 않을까. 저는 건강하게 만들 수 있을 것 같아요.
그 몸짱이 되려는 압박 때문에 더 건강이 안 좋아질 수 있다 생각합니다.
살을 좀 뺐거든요. 빼고 나니까 확실하게 몸이 건강해지는 게 달라지더라고요.
건강한 몸 만들기가 유행이긴 한데 무리하게 따라하려다가 망칠 수도 있을 것 같아서.
조금이라도 부지런하게 하면 일단 체력이 증진되는 게 바로 느껴지니까.
몸 만들려고 뭐 많이 먹고 하잖아요. 뭐 단백질 이런 거. 그거 되게 안 좋다고 듣고 이래가지고.
아니 뭐 유행이라니까 유행이면 따라하고 싶잖아요.
운동하는 자체가 몸에 건강하다라는 걸 이렇게 알고 있고 또 했을 때 몸에 또 이렇게 오는 게 확실히 반응이 있으니까.
So we saw what the average person on the street thinks about this issue, and it was overwhelmingly in favor of the yes team. Contrary to the online poll, which was much more even, for the citizens on the street, it was 80% for yes and just 20% for the no. But I imagine having lived in Korea, you know how we're very trendy and we like to follow, but yes. We're also very body conscious. It's almost like a greeting to say, oh, you've lost weight, oh, you've gained weight. They say this as a form of showing how they care about your health also, but I don't know. I mean, do you think sometimes that is quite extreme too?
But if you look at TV shows in Korea, I remember when I came here 5 years ago, there was a lot of TV shows about dieting, but these days I see TV show about working out to be like fit, not super skinny, to actually have muscles and have those abs.
But they still involve dieting too.
Yeah, but like a healthy diet, because you cannot work, you cannot build muscle if you don't eat like a healthy meal.
I don't think it necessarily relates to health and workout. I think it relates to appearances in Korea, because appearances is a big issue and people do tend to focus
so you're
much
arguing
on
against your argument.
No, I'm just saying it's not a health thing.
So it doesn't really make you
No, I'm arguing
fitter.
That. I'm arguing that it can make you healthier, and that's why I'm pro this. Right, but when the focus is on the appearance and on just looking good, and then it comes an obsession, and that's why we actually introduced the balanced idea of the fitness craze, right? Mm.
You know, Danny, you and I seem to have differing views on what a craze is. What are some crazes that you've been a part of, fitness crazes? If you could
fitness
give me
crazes?
An example, so maybe I could argue.
When you say fitness craze, I just think of like fitness focused stuff, Taekwondo or yoga or weight training. I guess I would
say
that.
See, that just seems to me like sports or activities, not a craze, not something that's here today and gone tomorrow.
Is that the definition you're using, that this is all stuff that's here today
that's
and gone tomorrow?
What it seems like, no?
No.
I think you're talking about the general societal trend towards more fitness. Okay. Is how I read it, because there's more now than there was 30 years ago.
There's, yeah. Right?
I think that's how we can define. Let's not get into, yeah, definition
the two
of
strands.
Craze.
Okay, so exactly. So there's the one overarching definition of what the fitness craze, which has started in the late 60s, early 70s. But then also within that, there's lots of micro trends. And I think there's problems at both levels. So I think at this overarching level, in terms of how fitness is constructed, is very problematic. Mm-hmm. But also at this smaller level of these micro trends. So can I give you an example of CrossFit? Have we all heard of?
We've all heard of it.
CrossFit. So CrossFit, the guru behind CrossFit is a man called Greg Glassman. And he's the CEO of the phenomenon, I guess. And so I have this little quote from Greg, and he says, "Of CrossFit, it can kill you. I've always been completely honest about that." And this was when he was challenged because there was increased incidences of people having this incredibly awful sounding, I don't know, like a disease called rhabdomyolysis. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly.
In the regular
population, it's got an occurrence of 0.06%, okay? And it's spectacularly higher within people who do CrossFit.
What disease is this?
So what happens? So your muscle cells explode. They die. They leach protein into your bloodstream. And then your kidneys, they try and clean this out of your bloodstream. But unfortunately, they're not designed to be in your blood, and so it easily overloads the kidney and can lead to all sorts of incredibly dangerous.
That's a very extreme. Yeah, let's be real. Like, I'm part of the fitness craze. I will never be that person that goes to like CrossFit and things like that. But it will encourage me to work out more.
There are Angelina,
you said yourself you're not working out these days, but you're on the team of the fitness craze, which doesn't seem right.
I'm mentally working out.
She did mention before that she used to work out.
I used to be one of those persons that I used to take long.
I mean, my point is this. There's a lot of information on fitness and whatever that's on the internet. That's very good for us. But a lot of the times, because it's a trend, you feel that you have to follow it. But you follow it only with the information. You don't actually go through with it. So if it just getting a lot of information about becoming fitter and actually following through with it and becoming fitter, I'm just wondering if there's a discrepancy between the two.
I think the majority of people are rational enough to draw the line between when working out becomes an obsession and becomes harmful.
But that's not what I'm asking. I mean, knowing that you have to be fit and then actually carrying through with it.
But it takes a while.
I think that in the end, it's a lot more simple to be healthy than most people think, right? And that's where it's important not to follow fads. And that's why I think something like CrossFit, for example, I think that's really extreme. And I've heard like a lot of about a lot of people getting injured through that kind of program. But there's a lot of extreme programs that market themselves like that. But at the same time, through those programs, more people learn you have to evaluate what kind of thing you're gonna do. And you as the consumer, it's up to you. It's your responsibility to make that choice. No one, no government, no person is gonna protect you from how to be healthy or unhealthy. You have to make those decisions on your own. So the more that things are learned about fitness, the better. The better that so that you can customize it for who you are, your lifestyle, and to truly be healthy.
So I think what you're saying there about it's your decision on your own, okay? That's a very important thing which we need to actually unpack because it's just not as straightforward as that. So this obsession or the way that fitness is characterized and the way that it's talked about in terms of what it is, okay, it actually hides other more pressing socio-economic problems which affect people's health in countries all over the world. So what the health or the fitness craze, what it says is it says that you are responsible for your own health. So it puts the moral burden onto you.
Of course you're responsible for your own health. Why shouldn't you be, right? It's your body and it's your responsibility to take care of that body because you shouldn't trust anyone else with your body and your life and your life choices. Mm-hmm. So I think it's good. And what fitness craze does is that it provides so many options and so many diverse things and you know, exercises and sports that one can do. So you can basically customize and choose the most suitable one for you in your context, even if you have a specific highly complex social background, right?
Yeah, so I'm wondering of these information, sometimes it will lead you to make better choices when it regards to your health, but it can also make you kind of neurotic and think that you have to work out more, that you have to diet more, you have to sleep more, that you're doing something wrong, maybe it could drive you to being a hypochondriac, maybe. Yeah. Can the fitness craze also have negative elements in that respect?
Yeah, I think in that sense, that's really true. Like, you see, it's really annoying to me the amount of, like, really poor information that there is out there.
So now you're acknowledging that there's a lot of poor information too.
Yeah, I think there's
How do you distinguish between the two?
You have to educate yourself. And I think it would be great if governments gave more information, better information. I needed to learn it sooner. But in the end, the only way to combat that is education, because you're not gonna, it's a multi-billion dollar
industry. Guys, I have to stop you because we've reached bullseye. Oh. So we managed to reach bullseye, but contrary to our online poll and the citizens on the street poll, where it was a resounding yes, it's 50-50. You only agree to kind of 50% of each other's arguments. So this could make it difficult to come to one sort of unifying conclusion. But you obviously agreed with each other on certain points. Mm-hmm. What did you agree on?
I mean, do you guys agree that the fitness craze could possibly make some people healthier? Would you be able to agree
of
even
course.
To that?
The people are doing the right actions towards fitness. Yeah, of course.
So they it creates more awareness of being fit and healthy.
Yeah, it creates more awareness. Yeah, people are just getting educated about it.
So then, what's the problem? What's the main problem?
We agree, though, that it has a potential harm. Mm-hmm. Though, the way that it's used.
So I think that's very important. We need to send a responsible message, right? So we need to be aware of the dangers that are inherent in different types of crazes. These crazes come up very regularly. So there's a new craze every year or every other year. And lots of these crazes do lead to more injuries, more accidents. So whether it's CrossFit or Zumba or Tambata or whatever it is, we have these new crazes and they all have... Zumbata has a problem with hip cracking, by the way. Stay away from
it. What is Zumbata?
What's
dangerous? Zumba, can you show us a little bit of
Zumba? What's dangerous?
Zumba is
like
the dance.
I know Zumba. It's a mix of all South American dances.
Yeah.
Zumba.
It's a new trend in dancing.
You're combining with Tabata.
Tabata, maybe.
Tabata, okay.
Zumbata.
Even the names are dangerous, okay? But we have to remember that these things are, especially for the uneducated or the people who don't have the information. So you're proactive in going out and seeking information, but lots of people aren't as proactive as that, and that's where the dangers, lots of the problems and dangers lie.
And if they go for it for the wrong reasons, just for the cosmetic, for the, you know,
just for
the,
that one summer.
that's right. The beach body phenomenon, that is a problem, right? So there's this idea of body image and how it's idealized. You're both young women. I mean, this should be more keenly aware of this than we are, right? Just how the idealized body image is.
Yeah. I like having a beach body.
Why were you on this?
Happy for you. No, because like him being in his beach fit like doesn't pressure me at all. Like, I'm happy for you.
Okay, so we do agree that the fitness craze can make us fitter.
It can.
Yes?
Possibly.
But it's, what can we say? I mean, I agree that fads, mm-hmm. passing fads and bad information is totally rampant in the mm-hmm. fitness industry. Mm-hmm. I can agree with that, and I've been, when I was younger, I was totally a victim of that. So, I mean, I definitely see that.
As a recovering addict, yes, Dan. As experience, yes.
Yeah. So
when you
brought
that up, we need to recognize that it's dangerous, especially for people who are ill-informed. Okay. So I think as long as we add something which includes this awareness that the micro trends or fads can be frequently dangerous, and mm-hmm. especially if they're ill-informed. Mm-hmm. So let's just say, tell me, what's your first
part? Yes, so we say, yes, the fitness craze can make you fitter.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but is often dangerous or are often dangerous and frequently ill-informed?
Okay, yes. So I think we've reached a unified sentence. Shooters asked, the fitness craze, can it make us fitter? Will it really make you fitter? And Shooters answered, the fitness craze can make you fitter, but can also be dangerous and is often ill-informed.
Yes.
Okay. Mm. Well, Shooters, that wraps it up for another show. Hope you join us again next time. Bye-bye.
Thanks for Zumbata class.
You should show us the...